Well, now we're going to have Vijay come back up and talk a little more about the specifics of MD-20 and its implications.
That comes up. Phil was counting the days that we have for the next peer evaluation. So I think one of the questions that comes up is, what is it that an AV needs to do to show that they're in compliance with MD-20? And what is it that the peer evaluators need to check when they do an assessment to make sure that AV is in compliance with MD-20? So we have tried to put together a few suggestions, and I think this is more representing the task force. But again, it's for each region at this time to decide how they're going to be doing it. With Azusa's permission, I'll speak something for the PAC region, what we talked about at the last meeting. But it's up to IAF to decide whether they want to do something at the IAF level or they just want for the regions to come up with what they're going to do. Next slide. So in terms of the implementation due dates, as it is currently proposed, this document was issued May 25th, 2016. And the application date is 25th May 2018, which would be by that time the APs would have to show that they have actually implemented MD-20. And in terms of the PAC approach that we have, which is to review AV preparation at next peer evaluations. So going forward, whatever peer evaluations happen, the peer evaluation team would be looking in terms of how much AV has actually, what steps they have taken to show compliance with MD-20, what was their preparedness, what have they done so far. And the PE team will review level of readiness and report it in the evaluation report. So in the evaluation report, they will make a note of what exactly was the level of readiness, because it's not effective, so if there's not going to be any non-conformity issues, that's just going to be more of a report. After the application date, which would be after May 25th, 2018, the documents are to be included in evaluation criteria, which would be part of the formal peer evaluation process. And the PE team will evaluate implementation, which would mean that has this MD-20 been fully implemented by the AV. So this is the PAC region, Azusa, I think you would agree to that what we discussed. And for other regions, to decide accordingly. Now, probably at some point you get tired of looking at this this competency profile. But a couple of things that I want to highlight. Again, Cynthia has said this before, but the next slide, please. So, what the intent or the way in which MD-20 has been written is that the level of competence for each region should be held within the assessment team, which is an important factor. So the MD-20 did not visualize that everyone needs to have all the competencies that listed. So it's based on the type of work that a particular assessment team member does. So the profile or the competency has to be aligned to their role, specific role is. So the AV shall have a competency profile. So you'll have to provide some evidence that yes, in fact, you did take into account the competency profile. Next slide. And again, some of the important considerations would be the foundational competencies are required of all AV assessors. So in terms of communication skills, the D series competencies is required of all the AV assessment team. And then the generic assessment competencies 1 to 5 under that are mandatory. So if you look at Annex 1, that's the mandatory part of it. Annex 2, which is Section C, the professional competencies should be considered. So what MD-20 is saying, they should be considered. It's not making it obligatory on part of ABs to do that when evaluating assessors team. But does not have to document evidence meeting each individual competency. So there are very specific competencies that are laid out. So the MD-20 is saying is each of these competencies should be considered. It's not saying that you have to necessarily include that as part of your evaluation process. So that is an important distinction. So when you look at it, You have to see what is the compulsory part of it and what is the optional part of it and who needs to have what specific competencies that's laid out. Next slide, please. And this is just a graphic illustration of that. So in this case, you might have a technical expert who might have the foundational competencies. So in this case, MD20 requires that all types, whether it's a technical expert or a lead assistant, everyone needs to have the foundational competencies. So you see the foundational competencies everyone needs to have. But if you see the technical expert in this case doesn't have any assessment competencies. So it's okay for a technical expert not to have that. Now it's your policy, but in terms of what MD20 says, it's not requiring a technical expert to have other competencies. Similarly, if you look at an assessor, the foundational competency is a requirement, so an assessor would need to have the foundational competencies. The professional competencies, you can decide how much of that, you know, it's possible that it needs, you know, the assessor needs to have some, but that's not really a requirement. And then you might decide that an assessor may not have any technical competencies or, you know, might not have a specific type of competency. So that's something. Similarly, for the lead assessor, now an AD would, you know, have to have the foundational competencies, but the other competencies would be, you know, based on the role that's performed. So I think that's an important consideration for each AD. You would have to see, you know, make sure that the foundational competencies cuts across all the assessors, technical experts, lead assessors, and everyone who is involved with the assessment. But when you look at the other competencies, depending on the type of function they perform and the type of scope of their assessment, so you have to show, and we have been emphasizing this factor, that it's the team collectively that needs to have these competencies, and it's not individual for the specific competency. So I think that's important. So that's all I wanted to report on this, and it's up to each region to decide how they're going to do it, for IAF to decide how, you know, they want to implement it. So this was more coming after the task force in terms of what their vision was in terms of implementation.
No any questions for Vijay?
Thank you, Vijay. Can I just come back to one point, which is one of the areas of MD20 I do struggle with a little bit. In the competency profile, the illustration and the word show that an assessor doesn't necessarily need a technical competence. Now I have to say I'm struggling to envisage any use of an assessor where they don't need technical competence. I just can't picture it. This is a bit I've often struggled with, that I would have thought any assessor needs technical competence for the part of the job they're dealing with.
And I think, like, what, you know, again, the technical, probably there might be a difference in terms of understanding what the technical competence is. Like, it could be, you know, are you talking about technical experts, or are you talking about, say, expertise in terms of relevant standards? So probably all the assessors would need to have that expertise in terms of that. But again, that's an important consideration. Like, why would you have an assessor if you don't really have any, you know? So there would be some technical competencies associated, but again, it would be what exactly that entails.
If I can just come back, I mean, I'm not talking about technical standards, I'm talking about sector technical. If an assessor is looking at internal audit in a company, you have to understand the business of that company to understand how the internal audit process works. So I wasn't referring to knowledge of standards, I was actually referring to the sector.
Right. So Cindy, when you did the job analysis, how did this play into this? How did you define the technical competencies related to this?
I don't recall. I'll have to go back and look at the job analysis report. But you're talking at the sector level, and we actually have a graphic that Phil drafted that will help some of this, and I'm gonna put it up in a minute, but for sure, there is some level of sector competence that the assessor has to have, and in this graphic, which Vijay created, you also have lead assessors who obviously have technical competence. So it's a combination of the team, and I think he was just using this graphic to illustrate that it's some combination of the team that makes the whole requirement, not necessarily each individual assessor.
I think like in MD20, at this stage, we haven't really addressed the technical competency. We're just looking at the DEC level, we're not looking at this.
Go ahead.
I do believe that supporting what Kevin said, and making exactly the example that Kevin has said as well about internal loading, you should have a competence in relation to the management system. What are the purpose of doing this? Which are the activities, how they are performed, which way you are able to extract valuable field for improvement and things like that. But those isolated can be enough to have the technical competence in relation to that. But you need as well to understand the context and how much of these will impact as well potentially technical standard competence that you need. Because at least for auditors, we need to have that kind of knowledge, not individually, maybe collectively, and before there is a combination. If you have not that, you need the technical expertise or an assessor which will support the evaluation of that and which are the impact of the technical standards. So I do believe that the graphical, I took a picture just because it was as well, identifying myself, maybe potential lack of attention on the assessor side. So at least some black. I'm expecting to have something over there as well.
Same thing, and you pull up the other, our favorite. And I think if you look in terms of this MD20, the competency profile, at this time, MD20 is only looking at the generic assessment competencies, the professional competencies, and the foundational competencies. So I just put that up because that's one piece of work that we have not really done, we have not covered. So, the technical competency piece, the black piece, it is the one which relates to the specific standard competencies. And I think what we are also trying to do is, because there are other MDs, there are other standards that talks about these competencies, and the ultimate aim is to have one system which integrates all these different approaches. We don't want MDs to have different systems. So, what Cindy was talking, that, Phil attempted to create, and hopefully we can have that included, so that everyone gets a sense of that. Where does the various technical standards fit in this entire picture? So I think that's something we'll help them to.
We have that.
Yeah, so hopefully we can show that that's like to your point.
The competence approach, I think it's the only way to improve our systems. I tell you what I don't like is to try to standardize or to uniformize the tasks and the functions that everyone, every person in an accreditation body does. For example, for you, what you understand by a lead assessor, what you label a lead assessor, can have different tasks for you and for me. So using these labels, it's creating a lot of confusion. And that's what I don't like, because then someone might be very obscure and try to say, okay, you are a lead assessor, and then you have to do this. And I will have to say, that's in your system, not in my system. Okay? So I like the competence approach, I do support it. It has been very helpful. I can tell you that we have already identified that in some times we were asking for more competences than what we required for the tasks that the person were doing. In other cases, maybe we need to emphasize a little more some of the competences. But what I don't like is we have a uniformized or a standardized approach in that this is what you have to have and that. Because
right, yeah, I think this was meant to be an illustration, but your point is well taken.
You need to define the process. The process is these tasks, and for each task you define the competences, full stop.
Right, yeah.
And forget then, about the labels.
And each AB would have its own system in terms of designating what might be the system for one AB may not be the same. So it's for each decide, you know, what that definition means, what are their specific tasks, and make sure that that's aligned to their scope of work. Absolutely.
Other questions? Yes.
When we are utilizing the MD20, it's now a bit clear with respect to what we intend, what we expect to last from in the B, C, and D categories. But what will happen then during the evaluation when they're looking at specific areas? We apply what we are currently using now until when the specific documents come out, or what will be expected for the category A?
That's great. You cannot say, because you know, we haven't had MD20 covered that, we don't need to. So you would have to, and that's, you would have to rely on your existing system to show that how did you, you know, qualify your assessors for those technical competencies. So that's something, you know, you would have to do, and probably I would assume you have been doing it in the past assessment. So probably you will have to do that. And once we have this totality, then you can transition that process, but you would have to do that.
Do you want to add something at all? No? Okay. Other questions? Thank you, Vijay.